begin the scientific session. The first speaker will be Dr. Anne Ostrowski, who will be talking about updates in cross-linking.
Good morning. Thank you so much for having me come here and speak. I want to make sure you can see my slides.
Yeah.
Okay, wonderful. Okay, so I will be speaking about an update on corneal collagen cross-linking. When we have our patients come to us with a diagnosis of keratoconus, we want to do two things, right? First, we want to see, is their disease progressive? And if it is, we want to stop it and stabilize it. But we want to do this in concert with a concern for their visual rehabilitation. Otherwise, the stabilization makes no sense. So we frequently want to pair the stabilization procedure with some sort of visual rehabilitation procedure, such as giving them glasses, contact lenses, or something more invasive like intrastromal corneal segments, or perhaps pupil-guided PRK, if you have that availability. The rationale for cross-linking treatment, obviously, is first to determine, is there a progressive disease? And if there is, to try to diagnose this quickly, as without treatment, 12 to 20% of untreated patients will require a PK for visual rehabilitation. So to cross-link or not to cross-link, first, A, is the disease progressive? If yes, the second question should be, can the vision be rehabilitated at the same time or after the cross-linking procedure? If the answer is yes, then this is the way we proceed. Is corneal thickness a factor? In the US, it is. Outside of the US, that is becoming less of a concern, and we'll talk about some of the approaches that are being used to cross-link even thin corneas. I think I just lost my presentation there. Okay. Are you able to see my presentation?
Yeah, just make it slideshow if you can.
Okay. So
no, it's not slideshow. It's not slideshow.
It's not on slideshow. Not letting me. Okay, it's not letting me go to a slideshow. Can you still see the screen this way?
It's still not slideshow.
We can see the screen maybe, yeah, if you go to present.
Yes, you could see to see Excel or not to see Excel here.
Yeah.
Okay, great. Sorry. Okay. So the next question would be, is there corneal scarring in the cornea? If the corneal scarring is minimal and not visually significant, then cross-linking could still be undertaken. If the patient has had high drops or the corneal scar is central, that may not be the way to go. The degree of visual disability and the ability of to tolerate contact lenses is important in our decision-making to determine whether we proceed with cross-linking or not. Defining progression is important here, but progression of ectatic disease remains challenging and therefore explains the diversity of indices presented in the literature. Some people look at Kmax changes, some at corneal thickness changes, some at cylindrical changes. But really what we're looking at when we're talking about progression is sort of a tripartite approach. Is there clinical progression with vision changes, spherical equivalent changes, or corneal signs? And then we look at topographic or tomographic progression that looks at keratometric indices of steepening and thinning as the cornea progresses. And thirdly, biomechanical changes, such as decreased tissue strength and rigidity as the cornea becomes more thin. The tomographic progression indices, in 2015, the Global Delphi Panel on Keratoconus and Ectasia came up with a recommendation for progression defined as a change by 2 to 3 of these four parameters. The anterior radius of curvature, the posterior radius of curvature, corneal thickness, or an increase in the rate of change of the CCT from the periphery to the thinnest point. There's also a distinction made between looking at fewer Kmax values versus zonal Kmax. We'll talk about that. The Bellin ABCD nomogram has become a useful tool in looking at progression, as is the BAD-D on the Bellin Ambrosio display in Pentacam. So Kmax has been historically the single point of greatest curvature that's been used to look at progression, but it actually can be an unreliable marker for no curvature because it only takes into account a single point, ignores the posterior curvature, and frankly, marked disease progression can occur even with stable or decreasing Kmax values. The zonal Kmax, as a single measurement, appears to be a more reliable measure to follow for progression and represents a zonal maximal keratometry in a 3 millimeter zone, and it can be looked at the anterior surface or at the posterior surface. So the Bellin ABCD nomogram, the A is actually the anterior radius of curvature in a 3 millimeter zone. The B is the posterior radius of curvature in the 3 millimeter zone. C is spectrometry and D is vision. And these can be followed over time as a helpful tool to look for progression of disease. So this is an example of what this would look like. The yellow is exam number one, the green is exam number two. And you can see marked progression in all three parameters. Looking at corneal biomechanics, there are now two commercially available instruments on the market, one from Oculus, one from Reichert, and both rely on analyzing corneal biomechanical response to an air puff. Studies have validated that keratoconic corneas reliably display a softer eye with more deformity of cornea as the disease progresses and the contralateral effect after cross-linking. And there are now a couple of indices that are available clinically that could be used as helpful tools in looking at biomechanical progression during keratoconus. We're talking about approaches. The original Dresden protocol, which we utilized in the United States, the epithelium is removed, the cornea is soaked for 30 minutes in riboflavin, and then UVA light is administered for 30 minutes. This then creates crosslinks in the cornea and renders it stiffer. There are now accelerated protocols that have been approved that take less time, and also epithelium on protocols used in the world, not in the United States, that can be done quickly and also keeping the epithelium on. I think it's important to remember that when the epithelium remains on, there is a barrier to the riboflavin entering the intact epithelium. And so other things need to be done to help the entrance of that molecule. And secondarily, the oxygen concentration in the posterior cornea can also be a limiting factor to successful cross-linking in these cases. A couple of adjustable nomograms have also been developed by Mazzotta and Hafezi that now actually also allow us to cross-link some corneas that are quite thin. Cross-linking is an adjustable procedure outside of the United States. We can vary everything from total energy to UVA power to the light exposure. We can change how we administer the light, continuous versus pulsed. We can choose whether the epithelium stays on or off. And we can also vary the riboflavin concentration. This is just a quick blurb on Mazzotta's nomogram. It's a pachymetry-based accelerated epithelium on cross-linking approach that allows one to set the desired depth of treatment, sparing the corneal endothelium and including thin corneas of 250 to 400 micrometers. A safety endothelial margin of 50 micrometers is used. Hafezi came up with a sub-400 protocol that basically is an epi-off approach that uses no corneal swelling to treat corneas of a variety of thicknesses down to 220 micrometers. And basically he adjusts the parameters of the treatment based on the corneal thickness. So there are a variety of devices outside of the United States that allow fluence adaptation and standardization of customized accelerated protocols. And you can see you can vary just about every aspect of these parameters here. For the post-cross-linking evaluation, what do we look at? We look at uncorrected visual acuity or best corrected visual acuity. And if we're lucky, we get a little bit of an improvement, sometimes getting about a diopter to a diopter and a quarter of flattening. There's usually some haze, worse at 1 month postoperatively. And during this time, topographical measurements of the cornea may not be very accurate. So if you're looking to sort of qualify the effects of the treatment, you may want to look at densitometry to confirm that you have gotten your cross-linking line. You can also use anterior segment OCT looking for the demarcation line for the same purpose. You can also look at change maps, which are very helpful to see whether you've gotten some flattening in the center of your cornea. Talk about your patients about contact lenses. I usually tell them 4 to 6 weeks after the cross-linking they could be refitted. And then obviously we're always looking for question of progression despite the cross-linking procedure. This is a picture of a subtraction map where you can see a very nice flattening in the center after cross-linking. And for retreatment, the questions are, is the vision consistently worsening? Is there consistent steepening of the cone and on tomography and topography? And also now, the Belinet BCD progression index just recently has been updated with the ability to monitor corneas after cross-linking. There's now sort of a normative database there, and the patient's cross-linking data is entered into the database, and you can see the dotted line there depicts the procedure date, and comparisons are made going forward. Okay, I'm right on time. Thank you so much for having me speak.